Good afternoon. Thank you very much for that. The crib sheet that you have with you is purely for those whose Latin is perhaps not as polished as it once was, and you need a little help. The season's topics, as you've been told, might look more limited, the making of a masterpiece, but in fact, I think it's going to be a little simpler for audiences than last year, because I promise you there will be no music examples. I should say, no written music examples, so you can't be tested on your ability to sight read and join in. It'll simply be concerned, I think, with the sounds of music, that is, the results of the composer, but also the efforts of the performer in delivering the music to you. There are really two ways of looking at musical analysis. One could be the seeing and reading part of it, which means that you have to have a grasp of music notation, you have to analyze what's on the page, you also have to be aware of the biography, the archival material. We talked a great deal about that in last year's lectures. I think as a balance this year, I'll opt for the other side, which is simply, what can you, in the most informed way, get from simply listening to the music? That, of course, means you are listening to a single performance. And although it's available to everyone, it is only that one performance. And in the process of performing, the performer may emphasize one aspect or perhaps conceal another aspect. It's a great necessity, therefore, to indulge in hearing multiple performances before you can claim that you have a rounded appreciation of the work. But it's not intended to be a sort of survey that will provide information that's only accessible if you are reading the written note or the biographical material. We begin the year with Bach, we'll end the year with Beethoven. In between you have many famous names. In the case of the Bach and the Beethoven, what I thought would be appropriate would be to choose an example of the way they felt it was most effective to introduce themselves to a new public. In the case of Beethoven, it's his first published string quartet, where he wanted to make absolutely clear in minimum time and with maximum impact to his public what a composer he was and what he could deliver to them. And in the case of the Bach that we're hearing today, it was his first piece that he delivered to the public when he was appointed as the director of music and organist of St. Thomas's Church in Leipzig. This was 1723, and he stayed there for the rest of his life, basically. It was his composing center. It was there that you heard the first performances of basically all the cantatas he wrote, all the organ music that he wrote, the St. Matthew Passion, the St. John Passion, the B minor Mass, although he never heard the B minor Mass as a single piece. He only knew it as a series of separate movements that showed up on various Sundays. But it's important, I think, to realize the situation he was in as quite a young composer with a family to support, with duties as a schoolmaster. He had to teach not only music and train the choir and create his own compositions, direct the orchestra. He also was obliged to teach the kids Latin. So again, you might sympathize with the task in hand, but he wanted to introduce himself at a Sunday shortly before Christmas, 1723, with a work that would show encapsulated what he could deliver. Well, he knew, of course, the things that were liable to turn people off church music. It could be too long, it could be too dreary and melancholy and too full of guilt. It could drag on for hours and they would all be looking at the hourglass or looking out of the window and dreaming of something else. He had to grab their attention and keep their attention throughout a cheerful text. And I think that must be one reason why he decided the upcoming feast of Christmas, the cheerfulness of the Virgin Mary when she discovered she was pregnant by unknown means, cheerily saying to her sister, "Well, I don't blame anybody, it's praise to God." And the Magnificat was a text born from that sort of exuberance. It's also a text that, as you see, can be divided up into 12 little segments, and Bach treated each of these as a complete picture in a gallery, and I think that entitles us to, as it were, proceed through the gallery, looking at picture by picture, not referring to other reference books or archival material, but merely noting what is in the picture, what can the eye see, what can the ear hear, what do you make of it? You have to give a little allowance for the fact, of course, that the 18th century listener was already well grounded, not only in the Latin text, but some of the assumptions that lay behind it, and also, if they'd been regularly to church, as they would have been in Leipzig, they were acclimatized to a language of music that was used to implement and illustrate what the text said. You could put in a literal translation, if you like, of what it said there. You can also put in your personal observations on what the music, what the text is saying via the music that you choose to clothe it in. So, pretending you are the average listener in a fairly chilly church in Leipzig in 1723, November, you first of all hear the Magnificat beginning as a very cheerful and extravagant sound. You knew that your church had resources of orchestra and choir, but you hadn't always heard all of them together. And what you hear straight up at the beginning of Magnificat is a declaration that this is cheerful, flamboyant, three trumpets, timpani, oboes and flutes, that's quite a luxury, bassoons, full string orchestra, organ continuo, and a chorus not in four parts but in five parts. So it's about the most elaborated and flamboyant sound that Bach could accommodate in his church. And he takes the text and basically waves it at you. It's really rather nice. There's two things you can do with dramatic words. One is emphasize the rhythm of them. The other, as Bach knew, is emphasize the flamboyance of them. And you get exactly this, and you'll see it later in the setting of Magnificat. He chooses, first of all, the way everybody says Magnificat. Magnificat. Dum-pum, pa-pum. That's terrific. That's obviously military, fanfare-y, uplifting. And then you go into great melismas, which is the waving of banners and Magnificat going off on lots of notes and wandering around amongst all the voices, all the instruments, even the top trumpet who can wander around on semiquavers. It's a very, very flamboyant show. Thank you. That's the big scene, the biggest he could manage with his resources. And everybody must have been, I think, fairly impressed, because it was a lot of sound, a lot of people, a lot of virtuosity, a small and very happy and non-guilty text. And it's over in just about 2 minutes. You've got about 12 sections in this piece. The whole work lasts slightly under 25 minutes. So you've got about between 1.5 and 2 minutes for each sentiment. Having presented the great big picture, now, of course, you've got to come down to the fact that it's not a national celebration, it's a personal celebration, and it is Mary speaking to her sister Elizabeth alone. It's a one-lady show. And so from that exuberance that sets the title of the piece, Bach has to go straight into a number which presents one person, also cheerful, and as the Latin says, et exultavit, my spirit has rejoiced. Exultavit, also in Latin, accommodates the idea of jumping and dancing. So you have to have this picture of Mary's spirit, if not her body, jumping around in enthusiasm. He lifts out of what you've just heard the fanfare figure. You heard all those trumpets playing, bum, 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 up and down the D major arpeggio. And so he starts Mary's dance with yum, pum, pum, ta-ra-dee, a little triad, the same little figure. He wants to persuade you, of course, that she is dancing and exuberant, but with no interest in prevailing fashion. The difficulty, if you start a dance movement in triple time, one, two, three, one, two, three, is that everybody thinks, aha, he's writing a minuet, that's terribly fashionable, but also pretty secular. Does God like minuets? We don't know. We know that the court dances minuets, but that might not be the best reference point. And so he very quickly disrupts it with a little figure that you all know can't be from a minuet. He goes, yum, da-da-dum, da-da-dum, da-da-dum. That's not a minuet figure, it's not graceful, it's not danceable, it's very energetic, and it shows a little jump on each note. And so here she is singing in a non-minuet, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Saviour, and immediately you go down to a single speaker in this drama rather than the full works. Thank you. case you think you recognise the voice, yes, it was Emma Kirkby, who was sitting here only one lecture back, or something like that, talking about the art of singing. You'll see one of the things that Bach is in the process, incidental to his composition, showing off to his new employers, is the fact that they have some wonderful singers available to them who can hold these long, long breaths, and so you have this long trail of coloratura with no space for any breath in it. It gets worse later on in the piece as he absolutely tests the singers and shows them off in front of their employers for their technical skill. So now we've got down from the big scene to the small scene. You can't go on being happy forever, and the Latin text realizes that. And so you have a little turn towards the minor, which Bach respects. He has regarded the humility, the humbleness of his handmaiden. Modern translations, I notice, give slave girl, which I think is not quite the right thing, but I would stick with the handmaid. For behold, from henceforth, all generations shall call me blessed. It needs to be seen in the Latin, because what you need to notice is that the word order in the Latin, of course, gives Bach a wonderful opportunity for total surprise. You've had two closed-ending movements so far. He's now coming up to an aria, which, although it's very soliloquy and single voice for most of its time, has a possibility at the end, because the last two words in the Latin are omnes generationes, all generations. So it's from henceforth, shall call me blessed, all generations. And he takes that opportunity. It's a wonderful moment. So the aria goes into directly a chorus of omnes, 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 all the voices. It's one of these crowd effects. We hear them throughout the Passion settings. Of course, Bach was a great sort of cinema scope orchestrator in terms of the voice and the crowd, the effect you can get of bringing voices in with the same text, piling up the entries one on another, and when you think you've run the gamut, they're all starting again. So you get this effect of endless generations all making their claim on this thing. So it's non-stop until just before the end of that little chorus, they all come to a stop and you can hear them on a very triumphal but unfinished chord, and then off you go with omnes, omnes, to the end of the movement. Before that, though, you have a much more somber sound, and I think everybody in Bach's audience would have picked up various things. One is that this has a very subservient feel to it. They would have heard that the instrument that begins playing at the beginning, you're down to very small resources, one wind instrument, one soprano voice. But the oboe sound is not the normal oboe. It's, for this context, rather suitably, and I'm sure Bach was hoping some people in his audience recognize it, it's the oboe d'amore, so the oboe of love. It's pitched lower, and it suits the context, and even its own title suits the situation so well. He then gives it a line which absolutely follows the gesture of the handmaiden bowing down. It takes a figure. Humility is a downwards gesture. And so everything is this long S-shaped down and a little rise at the end. But you can see exactly, or everybody will make their own exact picture of the social status of this lady and the gesture she's performing, until you get to the words ecce enim, behold. The reason, you know, I am so humble, but behold, he has registered me, and everybody will say I'm very lucky. And then you begin to go upwards, and the voice says ecce, 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 ecce. All the phrases turn upwards, and this melancholy oboe d'amore is forced to go along with it. But it's a very internalized dialogue. A single voice and an absolutely imitating oboe part really amounts to one musical thought amongst spread between somebody with words and an orchestral colour without words. But just the shape, the sheer graphic outline, I think would have made its point. What they would, none of them, I think, have been expecting in church would have been this sudden bursting in of omnes generationes at the end, which is a wonderful shock. Of inspiration just to hesitate before the very end, and you round it up on that wonderful chord, and you think, surely they've now run out of saying omnes, omnes so many times, we must have a full count, then to just go on afterwards. I think there's quite a lot of hidden smiling in this piece. It is not a po-faced setting at all, and there are little nudges and comments and even jokes in here for those who wish to hear and see them. The next number is one such example, I think, although I leave it to you to work out. Quia fecit mihi magna, because he that is mighty has done great things with me, and holy is his name. It's set for minimum forces again. One singer, this time a bass, because this is referring to God, and one ostinato keyboard part. Bom, 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 pop, pop, bom, 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 just plugging along at the bottom, quite square. For this, though, you need, as the 18th century, of course, would automatically know what the setup was in this sort of performance. The bass part, the cello part, whoever was playing on the bass line, the bassoon, would have a written part. The bass singer would have a composed part. But the person who was playing the organ or the keyboard continuo would be reading from a bass part and perhaps some figures, shorthand for the harmony, but would be improvising the continuo part. That is, whatever was going on to elaborate, to build up, in fact, to magnify the bass part. So it's another version of Magnificat. He has done things to me, making me bigger than I was, in all senses. That is reflected in the procedure of performance. And there was Bach sitting there, given absolute ad lib to put down on the organ whatever chords and ideas he wanted. Most performances are not terribly elaborate at this point. They're quite decorous. This one is relatively decorous, although you hear what the organ is up to. But you can do all sorts of things with this bass line, running canons and parts in answer to it or in contrary motion. It's susceptible to a lot of showing off. I have a terrible feeling that Bach would have shown off just to point up the pun in the verse, that here he was making a great deal of something very little and elemental. Meanwhile, the bass goes on singing in his best sonorous style. This is David Thomas. Of the mightiness of God and the holiness of his name.
Quia fecit mihi magna, fecit mihi magna, qui potens, qui potens est. Quia fecit mihi magna, qui potens est, et sanctum nomen eius, et sanctum nomen, et sanctum nomen eius, sanctum nomen eius, sanctum nomen eius, et sanctum nomen eius. Quia fecit mihi magna, qui
more elaborate than I remember it. He's doing good work on the organ, and you have to remember that's improvising, God having a day out and building up a picture of accompaniment that can't be repeated because it was never notated. In contrast, now, Bach has to have something else. His mercy is from generations unto generations. We've had these generations already, so sensibly he knows this is not something to plug. We've had omnes quite enough. Out of it you can pick two things, I think. One is at the very end, to those that fear him. And so as well as being soothing and pastoral and comforting, there has to somewhere in it be a little element of the potential of being afraid. It's not just a gratuitous kindliness, it has to be earned, and you have to do the right thing. We haven't had a duet so far, you've noticed, and so this is an opportunity for a duet. There are many things a duet can do. One of them, of course, is to suggest stability. When you have a solo voice, it could go anywhere and is responsible to no one. and could waft around and can express a lot of things. When you have two voices, particularly two voices that absolutely shadow each other up and down, is a very good musical symbol of stability and reassurance and of something having been organized in advance. By chance, two singers can't sing exactly in thirds and sixths. So there can be nothing improvised about this. It's a built-in security blanket. And it's surrounded by orchestration that also reminds people of the traditional Baroque music for comfort and security. This means shepherds, pastoral music, lilting rhythm, rather like the pastoral symphony in Christmas Oratorio, or the pastoral symphony in Messiah, over a sustained, a drone bass like a shepherd's bagpipe. The colour is very nice. Bach chooses to use strings, but with mutes and flutes, and it's this usual romantic solution. Flute plus mute equals a very soft-edged sound, most comforting. And it's only at the very end, after all this comforting music, that you suddenly have the voices trembling, which Bach does by repeated notes. Everything else is running up and down scales, no events. And just at the very end, they sit on their notes and go and they're shivering on each syllable. He notates it with notes and dots. And you, as a singer, you have to decide exactly what sort of effect you're going to add to that, that carries the music but still gives this little feeling of trembling. It's a wonderful idea, I think, to have the two singers hardly ever parting company from each other. They're obviously hand in hand, arm in arm, absolutely locked together through the whole piece. It's a wonderful foil also, I think, for the next and sort of central chorus of Magnificat, which is Fecit Potentiam, Fecit Potentiam in German pronunciation, which is exactly the same as the Magnificat solution at the beginning. He takes both the rhythm of Fecit Potentiam and the flourishes. Fecit Potentiam, Fecit Potentiam, the dotted rhythm, is very alerting, and then put in a long roulade. That's fine. He's showing strength with his arm. Everything is fine until the absolutely horrible last moments. He scatters the proud, disperse, 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 disperse. All the voices go down. So on the page, you can see it falling downhill. But in hearing, you don't need to see it. You can hear it going down to the bottoms, and they fall off. And then you have this absolutely spine-tingling in the imagination of their hearts. And he said it twice. It's a very short coda in the mente cordis. And first of all, you get very strange harmonies, very incomplete, but wonderful harmonies showing complete imagination, wild ideas of where it's going to go, just the chorus. And then you get the same sort of thing set with full orchestra, who haven't had a big go for a long time since the beginning. And these trumpeters are waiting to do their thing. And it begins with one of these spine-shivering chords, everybody in on an absolute incomplete harmony, and with the trumpet playing the highest note that was really available to the trumpet. Now, trumpets were royal instruments. They were the preview of the purview, as they have the rich families. And so it's quite clear who Bach is pointing at with this scoring. It's the imagination of rich people's hearts who have been misled by worldly promises. And this is the perfect 10-second epitome, I think, of the sight of this trumpet going up to its top note and then falling off. If you needed music to accompany the film of people jumping from the Twin Towers on 9/11, this is the music of it. They're up at the top and they fall. Did they fall? Were they pushed? We shall learn later. But it's a spine-tingling moment, and Bach really underlines it because it is so different from the mood that he had set at the beginning, which was only 10 minutes earlier. Is a really horrible moment that you don't want to look when the trumpet's at the top, because you know he can't go any higher and he can't finish up there. He's bound to come down. Just one diversion from the picture gallery sequence at this point, because some of you may know there's been a lot of controversy, in fact, fisticuffs in musicological conferences over the question of how many people sang Bach We think of him as massed choruses. We know for sure he didn't have a large chorus. Sometimes he had a very small number of people, and over the last 20 or 30 years, there's grown up a lot of theorizing that most Bach was sung and possibly even played by one performer per part. That is, not only did you have a single first violin, like you have a single first trumpet or first oboe, but you had a single first soprano. And so all the choruses would be sung by the people who were singing the solos, and you would only have to have five people around to do that. That's what you've just been listening to. There was no chorus in there at all. It was only the five soloists who were singing what were called the choral numbers. If you follow the other line of thinking, however, and have a lot of people around, the effect is different. Here's exactly the same chorus. We can just go back at that and also cover the moment when you don't want to look at the top of the towers, with a larger chorus singing, the full size that Bach might have used if he'd roped in everybody. So good, I think. I can't take sides very much in this argument, because I think both versions work. The only thing being, the soloists who have to do everything in the first number complain to you about the amount of money they're being paid for doing so many people's work. After that little moment of horror, what you need is something very sweet, and Bach knows. And so you fill the hungry with good things, and the rich you sent empty. Excuse me, I've skipped. He put down the mighty from their seats. We have this one verse before I get to the sweetness. This is what I mentioned already. You wondered whether the trumpet jumped or was pushed. From the text of the next thing, you know he was pushed. God pushed him. He put down the mighty, because Bach takes that scale, tim da 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 da, that the trumpet fell through, as the beginning of the next aria, where the violins play down and down and down. And then he exalts the humble, and the violins all come up the other way, and the tenor with them.
Oh,
picture writing, and I think everybody can follow that by ear, going down, coming up, very simple. The descriptive powers of the next number, a little more complicated, but I think it's very easy to grasp. The sweetest sound available in his orchestra would be the two flutes. They were always connected with sweetness and beauty. They run around in thirds and sixths, the two of them. That's a very sweet interval. The emptiness, this is a very nice idea, I think. The bass line, instead of being sustained and with organ, is plucked by the cello. So pizzicato, the emptiest sound, and when it comes to the end of the number, on the cadence, there is nothing except one pizzicato note. You couldn't be sent away more empty than that. On the way to that cadence, though, you'll notice he really stretches the singer in terms of filling up with breath. I'm sure he must have had in the back of his mind this implavit. He filled them with good things. A good thing for a singer faced with an endless run of semiquavers is endless lung power. And you'll hear the one longest melisma, which is quite frightening in its length, where the singer manages not to take a breath. I just hope a lot of people laughed in Leipzig at that point, because it seems so beautifully set up. And for these next two examples, may we just play a little of each and then fade it so we stay within our time? Because the points I wanted to make about these next two in our trawl around the gallery are quite simple. One is he has helped Israel, his servant. It's mellifluous trio. The interesting point, though, is that it's Israel, and Bach very cleverly underlines this. He has a trio of voices and a plain chant, the old Magnificat plain chant, which was sung to the tonus peregrinus, the wandering tone. It was a plain chant that ended in the wrong key. It's ti-ra-ra-ra-ra-ra-dee-da-ra-ra-dee-dum, ta-da-da-dee-da-dum. It ends wrongly there at the end. So it was called The Wanderer because it went off. What more appropriate tag to add to the picture of the Israelites wandering in the desert than to throw this in? You had, of course, to know that it was tonus peregrinus when it struck up, but it was very familiar then, probably less so now. Let's just play a little and then fade and jump to the following track. The oboe giving that old-fashioned line with most beautiful part writing going round it. Deliberately beautiful, I think, a bit more beautiful maybe the scene deserves, but it's to set up the next number, which again is a slight nudge, as he said to our, as he promised to our forefathers, Abraham and his seed forever. And this Bach looks back to his predecessors in this sort of job. And he obviously considered that they wrote slightly boring, square music. I know all kids would say their parents are square. Bach goes still further. He portrays in a very, very square fugue exactly how square he thought the forefathers were of German music. And it goes absolutely in sicut locutus est in patris nos, square again. The next entry comes in exactly four bars, and after four bars the next voice comes in after four bars, and it is absolutely according to the rule book and extremely dull except that it's Bach, so you think something brilliant is going to happen, but it's just the initiation of it shows that he is pointing his finger at unimaginative, by the rule book, old-fashioned fugal writing. Little nudge he gives, of course, is having started as a fugue, by the time he's got all four voices in, he gives up on it being a fugue and takes the easy way out of writing chords, saying, you know, our forefathers didn't really struggle with fugal form, they just brought the voices in and then let them wander a little ad libitum. That's the end of the Magnificat text. It has to have a Gloria at the end. Gloria has exactly what you would expect in it for representing the Trinity, and that is triplets. You get three big cries of Gloria, and between them you get more of this crowd music. The crowd begins for the first Gloria to God, the Father, from the bottom. The basses, then the tenors, then the altos, then the two sopranos. It rises up. At the end, the Holy Spirit does the opposite and starts at the top and comes down. And in the middle, rather nicely, for God the Son, they're all mingled together. It's a soprano, then a tenor, then a second soprano, then an alto, then maybe a bass in here. And the whole thing is the mix-up of humanity, very nicely portrayed. In triplets, of course, representing the Trinity. And then you come to the final verse, as it was in the beginning. Well, as anybody by now can have worked out, all you do here is repeat exactly the music that you had at the beginning of the piece, and it's as it was in the beginning.
Gloria.
and you have exactly the music you heard and know very well from the opening Magnificat, as it was in the beginning. It's all rounded off. That in musical playing terms is about 25 minutes, but I think it must have been the most wonderful introduction to, for the Leipzig audience to the potential that Bach had. And he then delivered it every Sunday for the next umpteen years with a new cantata, all exemplifying that same sort of link between text, music, and programmable message that can reach the public without them having to have access to a score. So this is music without music examples, but entirely how a masterpiece works and how you can pick up its salient features purely by ear. Next week we go on to live performers on stage, and it will be Strauss and Brahms, looking under the bonnet a little bit at what you do with the assembly of six string players, not the usual string quartet, but a string sextet. Thank you very much.